Our experiences on how to make diagnostics of emerging viruses available in affected regions. But I have to be honest with you, maybe I have a little bit more experience on not making diagnostics available in this region. But I will share with you two stories, I hope you like them, to hear and then come up with some solutions. And I think you're the perfect audience to hear this view. And I already heard today similar conclusions, so I have nothing to disclose to you. So I would like to start with the first story. And it started with an outbreak in West Africa, the Ebola outbreak. And you all know how hardly this hit the population in West Africa. And at the moment that the numbers of cases were increasing, the WHO declared this outbreak as an emergency public health emergency situation of international concern. And it's important to notice that from that moment onwards, there were actually many actions taken, and actually as a positive side effect, diagnostics, Ebola diagnostic tests were put on the in the view, and FDA approved this first Ebola diagnostic test. And 1 month later, it was WHO who approved the first Ebola test to be used in this emergency situation. And by the time that the first case of Ebola reached Europe and US, Ebola was all over in the news, and more companies were putting their test on the list of FDA and WHO. And you see that a lot of effort was put in the development of this test. And by the end of the outbreak, even three more tests were approved. But then you see there is a gap. After the outbreak, less attention for Ebola was there. And by the time that there, and with this current outbreak in DRC, one more test was approved by FDA. And you have to know that from the beginning, almost 75 companies were working on an assay, on an Ebola test. So in total, 14 were approved by either FDA or WHO. And this is the list which is currently available. And actually, we were one of those that also developed together with a company an Ebola diagnostic test. And I have to say, I was at that moment quite proud to have this very easy to use test. And it's an all-in-one system. You have to put in your sample, the results come out. It combines all extraction and PCR analyses, and it was approved by FDA in 2016. So it was not used in the West African outbreak. But then, 2 years later, the Ebola outbreak in DRC, like you all know, we were asked to give some diagnostic support by our colleagues in DRC, and then we thought, okay, let's provide them some of this Ebola test. But unfortunately, the company that was producing this test told us, you have to wait 3 months. So in the context of an outbreak, you don't have this time. So we were really disappointed, and I was like, is this the only company who's struggling with this kind of problems to provide this test after 2 years of silence? So actually what I did, I contacted like commercially available companies that have commercially available diagnostic tests available that were listed by FDA and WHO. And like you see in green, I don't know if you see it very well from behind, but only a few tests were rapidly available by the time of 2018. So, and from those, only few were used in the outbreak. So luckily, this very easy system, the GeneXpert, was available for our colleagues in DRC. But this is really something that is a problem which several companies are facing, and this is why we have written this comment in Nature. But of course, there is more than Ebola. We have heard it today, Lassa, yellow fever. And for this presentation, I was looking to some outbreaks that were reported very recently, only January, February this year. And what you see many more viruses, arboviruses and viral hemorrhagic fever viruses need our attention. So that brings me to the second story. And years ago, we started with the development of a multiplex tropical fever panel, because based on my experience on implementing real-time PCR testing in our institute, but also in African settings, I was convinced that targeting multiple viruses in one system would be very helpful for patients that present with acute fever. And we were able to develop a test that targets all these viruses that are mentioned on the screen, like dengue, chikungunya, Zika, yellow fever, together with malaria. And we were not the only one who were thinking in that way. Similar approaches, syndromic approaches, were taken by other companies like BioFire and like Altona with Aleri. And even last year, my colleague was here and presented a poster on the potential of this tropical fever panel, and we were able to evaluate it in our setting in the institute, but also in Senegal, with the help of the mobile laboratory provided by the Presence Foundation and with the help of colleagues in the Institut Pasteur. And for those that are having a nap, this is, I think, the most important slide of my presentation, so it's time to wake up. If you ask me, as a molecular biologist, what is the reason of developing this test, then this is the answer. When I saw these pictures and I received it from my colleagues, I was really emotionally and touched by the fact that finally this test reached its destination, its final destination. And my hope is that this test could be used in many African countries. And although it's only a prototype test and maybe needs a little bit more of optimization, I really think this is the kind of... I'm sorry. This is the way forward we have to go. But today, again, I have to disappoint you, because a company that worked together with us is not interested to further produce or commercialize this test. So at this moment, we are not able to bring this test to the affected regions, which is very sad. But what's the reason? Of course, the cost is high. And from a company point of view, I can understand this, because the company we work together with are more interested in oncology, and the interest in infectious disease is low, especially because there is no market. I'm not a business person, but I can understand if you cannot sell a product, then you cannot justify the cost you have to make for that. So, and it would take maybe 2 more years or 5 years to really have this commercially test available to roll out in these regions. So I think companies really need incentives to justify this cost. And also, it takes maybe too long, and this process should be accelerated, especially as part of epidemic preparedness. So after hearing these two sad stories on how we were not able to finally bring this diagnostic test to their final destination, I think we have to go forward and look for solutions. So today I really would like to make a call for action. And what I think is, how can we tackle this low interest of commercialization by companies? I think we need to create this market, and this can easily be done by performing or using this diagnostic test in surveillance system. Then this test is already available, and then you create a market. I will come to that later. Secondly, there should be incentive for developers, so there is need for funding. And to accelerate this process and to ensure that there is sustained availability of this test in affected regions, there should be an integrated diagnostic approach. So surveillance. So if your test is already in your country and used in surveillance systems, then if there is an outbreak, you only have to scale up the production. But everyone is trained, platforms are there, tests are used, you know how it works in your setting. So, and to show you that surveillance has really an impact, this is a very nice paper and a nice example of Uganda that implemented surveillance. And after they had struggled with some viral hemorrhagic fever outbreaks, and they implemented surveillance, and at this moment they have about 20 sentinel sites, you really see a significant decrease in the number of cases indicated in blue, and also the duration of the outbreak was really shorter, like you see in the pink bars. So it really has an impact. And there are many more nice examples of surveillance systems, like in Senegal, and if you combine it for arbovirus, it's a mosquito-based surveillance system, that's even better. And also research can really make a surveillance system stronger. As you know, what at that moment is circulating in your country. So, and also Africa CDC is really engaged for strengthening health system and to integrate laboratory networks are nice examples of that and surveillance systems. So this is really the way forward. Second thing, funding. I was trying to understand, and I said I am just a regular molecular biologist, and I tried to understand how is it possible that companies struggle with this market. So I came up with this the value of debt curve, and companies, when they start, they have to have funding for research and development, but the problem and the funding gap is mainly at the moment that the process of commercialization start. And if a product has not reached this critical point of success, this gap is too big to bridge. So I think it's important that we look to this in this way and try to make a bridge in this gap. And to further trying to understand the situation, I was looking to websites to understand why are some companies or startups failing, and I came up with this in this website where there were startups revealed why they failed. And this quote I was thinking was very nice to show you, because it states that if your idea starts with we're building a platform too, and you don't have $1 billion in capital, find a new idea now. So I was thinking, yes, maybe I made that mistake, but because every failure is one step closer to success, I really believe this, we have to go for more sustained investment in diagnostics, and there are many papers on that, and also FIND have already made an estimate on how many million dollars are needed for the coming 5 years. So, but most importantly is my third point, namely integrated approach. And there are also very nice papers on that where you see for diagnosis of fever syndromes that it should start at a community level, to go to a district level in hospitals and reference laboratory, and that this should be nicely integrated. And like also described by our chairperson here in 2016, this integration of laboratory networks and surveillance systems are very important. So also FIND is can bring these key stakeholders together and is really advocating for global forum for diagnostic preparedness. So, and I think because sometimes diagnostics are like the little brother of vaccines and treatments. So I think we really also have to partner with the world of vaccines, because they already have these preparedness systems in place, and it's important to have a good balance between vaccines and targets, and that your diagnostics are adapted to that. Also, Gavi, like explained in the previous talk, has a nice business model. So, but most importantly, and this is how I would like to end my talk, is that the implementation of this diagnostic test should be done in the field, in the regions where they are really needed. And the selection of the diagnostic test, because many companies or research institute develop this test, there should be some prioritization of which one is the best, like do we go for a syndromic approach, do we need a multiplex PCR approach. It should be rapid and easily a test that is easily to perform, and of course not too expensive. It should be rapidly available, and this is especially important in the context of outbreaks, and as I like to explain to you, to make them sustained available, I think they should be implemented in the existing surveillance systems. So how to coordinate all these things? And I think there is not yet a global diagnostic alliance, but I think this is really needed in the field of diagnostics. And I like the words of the director of African CDC in this paper that was published in Nature this Monday, where this will need many commitments, but there is a reason for hope. So to conclude my talk, I think let's remove the question mark and make diagnostics of emerging viruses available in the affected regions. And I think therefore we really need a global diagnostic alliance that integrates all companies, governments, international health organizations, laboratory networks and research institutes. And then if it covers all elements from the beginning with the start of the design and development and the research around this test and validate and implement this test in the countries, and make sure that there is a sustained manufacturing and stockpiling and surveillance ongoing, then I think everything can be improved. So I would like to end with acknowledging all the collaborating colleagues in this work, and I thank you for your attention.